Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to what I hope is going to be a very interesting conversation this evening with former General Secretary of the Bharatiya Janata Party, Mr. Ram Madhav, who has just come out with his new book, This Because India Matters. It's also available on Amazon in case any of you want to order. There's a link running at the bottom of the scroll of the screen. And I would like to welcome Mr. Ram Madhav to this conversation. And we hope we get to discuss a lot of things, as we have done in the past, on several occasions when I've had the opportunity to interview you. Now, when I was going through this book, Ram Madhav Ji, the first thing I found was that these are a collection of your columns, which you have written for various publications across the country, on various issues to deal with the Sangh Parivar ideology, how you view the world, how your ideological world is constituted. Referring back to a lot of the conversations that we have had in the past and which culminates in this book, there is an attempt, I feel, and which you have been active at in the last few years, to reach out and make civil society more receptive to the Sangh Parivar ideology, to explain the worldview of the Sangh ideology apart from whatever is available in traditional pedagogy in India and in academic circles. Could you please explain a little bit about that exercise? Because I felt when I read this book that this was a sort of either the midpoint of that exercise or a culmination of that exercise.
Thank you, Nishla, and my thanks to the Kalinga Literary Festival hosts for inviting me to participate in this discussion. You are right, Nishla. This book, Because India Comes First, is essentially a compilation of my writings on several issues, mostly, of course, about nationalism, about culture, about the country and its identity, its history, and all those things. I have been an RSS Pracharak for last almost 4 decades now. In this long period of working for the organization, I have been fortunate in the sense that I was given responsibilities more to interact with the outsiders, non-RSS people, than probably the members within the organization. Yeah, you can say that. Not essentially, you know, communicating with the converted alone. I don't use the word preaching. Yeah. Communicating with the converted, but rather a sort of reach out has been my task for many years. Firstly, I used to edit Sangh's magazines. Then later on in 2001, I became the spokesperson for the RSS. I have become the interface with the intellectuals and outside world. So I felt that something is missing in our communication, essentially. While we do such a wonderful work for the country, for almost all the sections of the Indian society as RSS, as an organization, and a host of the Parivar, the entire bouquet, if you want to call it, of RSS organizations, phenomenal work we do. But somehow, somewhere, we missed out on the communication front. We communicate very well with our cadres, but with the outsiders, somehow this communication has not been so very effective. We still were doing it. So I thought that my writings should help in communicating the stand, the ideas, the thinking, all this to the larger audience. Fortunately, I have been fortunate enough to have support of many important media houses. And also, over the years, I have written extensively about RSS thought, essentially, which is, again, about how we want to see this country develop, this culture protected and promoted, and all those issues I have written. And I am thankful that Amazon has come forward to publish all of them. Not exactly all of them. I mean, I have written extensively, but select about 50 to 53 articles into the form of this booklet. This book.
So you would say that this was, can you just explain a little bit about what was that outreach like? These are, of course, writings, but in terms of just setting up some sort of an ecosystem, thought ecosystem, Because when we have written about the RSS, or you know, we have found that, as you said, a lot of the outreach in terms of physical social work, etc., is extensive. The thought outreach is not so much. Can you also tell us about your other efforts at putting the thought outreach together? And then we can come to some other issues like Kashmir. Yeah.
Yes, I would say that in the process of gradual evolution, the RSS as an organization has started opening up more to the non-RSS sections of the society and the world in, I would say, mid-90s. A new wing was started in RSS called the Sampark Vibhag. That was when the outreach had started. Otherwise, you know, for those who, like you, Nishtala, you yourself have been watching this organization so closely, we used to be a very reticent organization. From that reticence to greater openness, I'm sure people like you would certainly acknowledge the fact that from sometime 10 years ago, 15 years ago to today, there is much greater openness in the organization. Openness in the sense that an urge to connect with outsiders, even with adversaries, talking to them, meeting them, reaching out to them. And in the process, presenting the organization's views and ideology and its positions on various national and international issues in a very, very cogent, coherent, and very modern way. That evolution I have myself seen, experienced it over the last several, last couple of decades, I would say. In fact, there is an article in this book which became a little a sort of a discussion point even within the organization. I called it the Glasnost movement for RSS. Glasnost movement, the word Glasnost was generally associated with the erstwhile USSR. So some in RSS also felt that, you know, the word Glasnost doesn't apply to RSS. But what I tried to say in that was that from a time of reticence to today, we have reached a stage where we are very much open. Glasnost, which Gorbachev used in mid-80s in USSR, was about openness, which had led to a big transformation, which he called as perestroika. So I borrowed that word only to suggest that greater openness has been the hallmark. I tell you, in 2009, Sri Mohan Bhagavat
became the collapse of the USSR. So that's a very clear point.
I did not use the word perestroika in that article. I only used the word glasnost. Glasnost meant openness. In 2009, the RSS chief, who became the chief only in that year, Sri Mohan Rao Bhagavatji, he had a meeting with 30 ambassadors of European countries over lunch at the house of one of the ambassadors. It was such a big reach out for RSS to reach out to the European world through their ambassadors. From there to today, just a few days ago, the RSS chief has addressed all the eminent intellectuals of the country through the medium of virtual medium on the topic of the role of Bharat the post-COVID world order. Now look at the kind of topic, look at the kind of outreach that we are attempting today. So I felt that this outreach was very critical to reshaping the organization also, but also making the organization, its thought process, much more contemporary, much more relevant, and much more effective for the changing times.
Okay. You have spoken in detail right now about all of those things. And even when you joined the BJP, when you seconded to the BJP, we found that you had your beats, so you know, as such, as General Secretary, or your area of work, which you had been assigned by the party president, were areas which were ideologically extremely important to the Sangh Parivar, namely Jammu and Kashmir and the Northeast. Jammu and Kashmir, of course, because since the Jansan's birth, this two separate constitutions, etc., had been and removal of Article 370 had been one of the core issues of the Sangh Parivar. And the Northeast also, because those are very sensitive border areas, tribal areas, and areas where the Sangh always felt that there was a lot of dominance of different kinds of cultural tendencies, etc. And they wanted some sort of ingress out there. So I wanted to know, how was your experience there? And how do you, and you managed to form a government in most of the places where you did enter. But the area of the state of Kashmir has been a bit of a strange experience for you or and the rest of the country, because on the one hand, you did form a government with the PDP. And on the other, the moment 370 was removed, all of them, including your former allies, including people like Sajjad Lone, who have been your fellow travelers, were clapped into jail. And Mehbooba Mufti was the last person to be let off. How do you reconcile in terms of Kashmir? Because there is a sizable bit about Kashmir in your in the book. And you do say that if anybody thought that Narendra Modi's government, when it comes back with a 303 MP majority, will not act on what is an article of faith for the Sangh Parivar, they were fooling themselves. 370 was going to go, etc., etc. But then how do you reconcile it with, you know, putting political leaders in jail and doing it the way it was done, and your previous relationships, the alliance that you forged and the alliance government that you ran in Jammu and Kashmir?
I was given the responsibility of the party in 2014 as its general secretary. I remained an RSS Pracharak. I continue to be an RSS Pracharak even now. So you are right. When I came into the party, I was given the responsibility of the areas which are, I mean, godforsaken, I would say, where, you know, BJP almost did not exist in areas like the states in the Northeast, or very difficult state like Jammu and Kashmir. I would say it was my good fortune that I was given those areas as my responsibility. And as you rightly said, in the Northeast, when I took up the responsibility, we had four MLAs in Assam. But other than that, in the rest of the seven states, we hardly had any presence there. Two MLAs, one MLA here and there. From there to today, out of the eight Northeastern states, we have seven states with BJP-led or BJP-participated governments, which is in a way a big achievement. You are right. See, before joining the BJP, in the RSS, I used to also work in the team that used to draft resolutions to be passed in RSS meetings. Those resolutions used to be on national issues. Not a single year used to pass without we drafting at least one resolution on Kashmir and one resolution on problems in the Northeast. So those issues which were very dear to us in the RSS or in the general Sangh Parivar, they came into my kitty when I became the general secretary of the party. So looking back, I feel very happy that in many of those challenging areas, the party and its organization have been able to make major inroads. That remains a great matter of satisfaction for me. But Kashmir remains one of the very, very contentious issues even today, unfortunately. And I mean, viewers will agree with me that it's not a problem created by us after we came to power. It has been a simmering, a very difficult, complex problem going on right from the time of the independence. What we did was, after we came to power, we tried to see if we can play a direct role in managing the affairs of the Jammu and Kashmir state government. Whether through that process we would be able to find a good answer, good solution to the problems in the state. We had one opportunity in 2015 because the mandate was so very badly split that the opportunity or the challenge was that you work with one of the Valley parties. We tried with NC. NC initially showed interest but subsequently said no. Then we were only left with the option of going with PDP. I know that a lot of criticism happened at that time. But in politics, sometimes you have to change bedfellows. I mean, strange election things happen in politics. We experimented, I don't call it experiment, we attempted seriously for at least 3 years to see if BJP participated government can improve the situation in the valley. I would say a lot of good things we could do in 3 years, but at a point came when we decided that no, in the larger national interest, in the larger objective of the party, or mission of the party, this particular alliance was not helping us. So we decided to walk out of it. Subsequent events, everybody knew. Now, as far as Article 370 abrogation is concerned, once that happened, yes, a large number of the valley leaders especially have been put under detention for varying periods. Some had to remain in detention for almost more than a year or so. But initially, after 3 months, some junior level leaders have been let off. This was based on certain security assessment. Remember, nullifying of Article 370 was a very, very big step taken by Prime Minister Modi and Home Minister Amit Shah. It's a historic thing. We always wanted it to happen. It finally could happen 1 year ago, about a year and 4 months ago in August last year. So naturally, there was anticipation of a big political and otherwise social fallout. To manage that fallout, these leaders were arrested. In that, yes, you are right.
But people like
who have sailed with us were also arrested. I see. If you ask me personally, whether Sajjad Lon should have been treated on a par with all others, I would personally say probably he could have been handled differently. Probably, but my view is a personal view. But there is a security view.
I'm sure there is a security view, Ramadhatji, but now that the DDC elections are taking place and at some point of time we hope to have assembly elections in the state, this entire exercise by the government to say that a democratic government should be established in the valley, some of that rhetoric does get nullified by the fact that political party leaders, mainstream political parties in Kashmir were put in jail. Now, how do you get over something like that?
Firstly,
that will create very strong feelings.
Firstly, I tell you one important fact through you to the viewers of the session. As I mentioned to you, only first 3-4 months, a large number of leaders were put behind bars. I'm talking about the immediate aftermath of the decision on 5th August 2019. A few months they were incarcerated. But November onwards, most of them have been set free. MLAs were free. Other leaders were free. But I tell you, PDP, NC, the so-called valley parties who claim to be mainstream parties, refused to undertake political activity even in spite of the fact that their leaders were free. They were in the villages, they were in the towns, they were free. But they refused to undertake any political activity. They're telling us lots of excuses they started giving. Only parties which were actually doing some work at the grassroots were parties like BJP and this new party which came into existence, Mr. Bukhari's party. These were the people available for the Apna party. Those parties were active. NC and PDP, when panchayat elections were being held, their leaders were free, but they boycotted the election. After all, grassroots democracy was slowly taking shape in the state. They should have participated. True, senior leaders were in jails. But all of them
forget about their hurt feelings.
No, I'm saying this is all excuses. I tell you today also, today everybody is free. Nobody is in jail today. DDC elections are happening and those parties are participating.
Yeah.
Let all of us encourage this kind of grassroots leadership to rise. That is the whole effort of our government.
So now let's move from Kashmir, which we could talk about endlessly if we allow ourselves to. Let's move to the Northeast, your other big assignment. You said that when you took over, there would be, you all just had 4 MPs, MLAs in the Assam Assembly, and that's about it, and hardly any kind of ingress into the other states of the Seven Sisters. Now you're in a position where most of the governments are either run by you or are in alliance with you. Regional parties which are in alliance with you and are part of the NEDA. That journey seems extremely fascinating. And one thing that stands out for me, because every time Amit Shah ji, who was party president at that time, or anybody, any senior leader used to go to the northeastern states, the big question used to be asked, what are you going to say on beef eating? What is going to be the BJP or the Sangh Parivar's view on beef eating? Because it's quite prevalent in the northeast. It's part of the cuisine. And how do you reconcile big, huge cultural differences and contradictions between what the Sangh Parivar subscribes to and what are the cultural norms in the areas where you want to have political influence? How did you manage? Because these are all culturally extremely disparate sort of places from the Hindi heartland, which is supposed to be the strength area of BJP.
No, firstly, one need not have this view or feeling that everybody in the Northeast is a beef eater. It's not so. Assam, Tripura, Manipur, even large parts of Arunachal Pradesh, all these areas, they are not essentially very big beef eating societies in that sense. But yet, there are states, there are regions which are culturally different from each other. Take the rest of the country. Here also you see a lot of differences. You are from South India. Next door to you is Kerala, where beef eating is very prevalent. So there are such issues in the entire country, just as they are there in the Northeast also. But Northeast, the bigger question was, a party which used to be seen as a Hindi party, Hindu party, North Indian party, for it to gain such large inroads, and in a span of about 4-5 years time, because the first election was, if you recall, it was in 2016, Assam.
Assam, yes. I recall traveling Assam around that.
And incidentally, before that, there were two elections in the country. One was in Delhi, we lost badly. Second was in Bihar, there also we lost. So when we entered into the election fray in 2016 early, Assam, Bengal, Tamil Nadu, Kerala. Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Bengal, we again lost all the three. So only state we won was Assam, and after the 2014 election. It was a great victory. It gave a great morale booster to entire country. But starting from there to the last election in Tripura, or I would say rather Sikkim, this journey has been really very fascinating. I would give credit to 2-3 factors. Number one, of course, Prime Minister. See, Prime Minister Narendra Modi is a huge hope giver to people in the Northeast, because he has made Northeast a very important part of his governance. He sent ministers every 15 days to the Northeast. In one state or the other, a center minister used to be there. So through that process, he has been able to give some hope, some trust to the people of the Northeast. That became a very big factor. Second factor is, of course, we have been able to get good leaders from other parties, from Congress. You know, some people point out to me, you see, leaders in Northeast in BJP are all from other parties, which is a fact. They are all very big leaders. They all came to our party. Third, of course, is our karyakartas. I tell you something very on a lighter vein. In Nagaland, one day I was working with one of our local leaders. I was going for a campaign. In the campaign, he was giving a speech to his people that, you know, what do you know what is BJP? BJP is Bharatiya Jesus Party. So he went and told them with that. So trying to tell people that no, BJP is not against Christianity.
Not a Hindu party.
It's as much our party. It's as much the party of the Nagas, the Mijos, the Meghalaya people, the Garos. See, that hard work of our karyakartas also has helped. Today, let me end by saying this, that not just me, the whole country should feel really happy that you go to the remotest corner of these states, whether it is Nagaland, or it is Meghalaya, or it is Tripura and Manipur, which abut our neighboring countries like Myanmar or Bangladesh, you will see a BJP flag there and a national flag there. India's national flag is fluttering in the remotest corners of our country in the Northeast. That is because of the hard work of our Karyakartas.
Well, going from the national flag to diplomacy and foreign relations, which you are extremely interested in and is one of your areas of study and interest, but is not so much mine. I just want to ask a very straightforward, sort of simple question, which has a complicated answer. You know, we keep saying that, you know, in terms of geography, you can't choose your neighbors. And in our neighborhood, we have found that we are deeply unpopular in many of our neighboring countries. You know, our relationship has deteriorated, like with Nepal, for a while with Sri Lanka, for a while with Bangladesh. They were very upset with us on the CA, NRC issue, etc. How do you look at all these developments? Do you think India should just go ahead and keep doing its own thing or be sensitive to the fact that we share borders and relationships which go back a long way and which were based on mutual accommodation and also protecting each other's egos?
I have written extensively about it in my book, and there is a full section on the India's relations with the world. In that also I mentioned about it. Look, I agree with you. The English actual saying is that you cannot choose your parents. Similarly, you can't choose your neighbors either. So you have to learn to live with them. But we are in a very peculiar geopolitical, geostrategic scenario in which in our neighborhood, we are two countries which are very big countries, India and China. We are fast-growing economies. India, China, of course, is definitely ahead of us. So between our two big countries, which are geographically located in the same area, we rub shoulders. We have a border about which there is a huge dispute also. I have written extensively about the dispute also. So fortunately or unfortunately, there is a competition between our two countries. Because we want, we both want our influence in the same region, same Indo-Pacific region. So there is an inherent competition. India has always managed this competition in its own way. We used our cultural relationships, we used our civilizational bondings, we used our age-old historical linkages, since you mentioned about Nepal and Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka and India fought the independence war together. The leaders in Sri Lanka and leaders in India during the freedom movement had very close relationships, close exchanges. So we have a historical relationship, we have a civilizational relationship with countries like Nepal. We have always used that to maintain strong friendship with our neighbors. But the point is that your point that you are raising is a result of this competition between our two countries, India and China. This competition is leading to occasional, strains in relations with our neighbors. You are right. Today, people see some kind of strained relationship between India and Nepal. But I can tell you, it's just a temporary phase. Countries in our neighborhood, we share same civilizational bonds. We share historical relationships. So it's no longer, it's not possible that we will become enemies. There could be temporary strains. We have to be diplomatically much more sensitive, much more proactive. I would certainly say that we probably have to do, Jim Mattis, who was Secretary of Defense under President Trump for some time, he one day walked into the State Department, US State Department, and told the Secretary of State straight in his face that, you see, if you don't burn enough midnight oil, give enough money to me. Please understand what he meant. If diplomacy doesn't do hard work, the duty will fall on the defense. If you don't handle diplomatically well, security becomes a challenge.
No, so that's a point well taken. But that's a point well taken. But Ramadhav ji, I wanted to ask you specifically in relation to Bangladesh. They are pretty upset with us over the NRC specifically. And that has been also something that the BJP has been pushing for a very long time, and they really put a lot of their political goodwill on stake, you know, the political capital on stake to push this through parliament. I remember one of the first stories I did when I joined the Hindu in 2015 was this particular story of this kind of a bill coming in, which would delineate the religious identities of people whom India would give refuge to. So how would you address that question on certain domestic policies that we have undertaken, which are impacting our foreign relations?
Yes, Nishtala. I have again written extensively about the NRC issue also, National Register of Citizens issue also, and also the second issue, the Citizenship Amendment Act. Both have, repercussions across the borders. You are right in pointing out that how countries like Bangladesh would react to it. One must understand, this is the thing that we have explained to our friends in Bangladesh also, including the people in the government there, that the NRC was actually an unfinished agenda of the 50s. Entire country, rest of the country had completed its citizenship register in the early 50s with the first election, the census and all that. But that process could not be undertaken in the state of Assam for various political reasons at that time. That process was completed through this NRC this time. So it was not about, you know, against any particular country or any particular neighbor. It's about completing the process of identifying the genuine citizens of India. Similarly, Citizenship Amendment Act also, there were a lot of misconceptions that through that somebody's citizenship is going to be finished off, Muslims will be made stateless, their citizenship will be taken away. All these things were pretty bogus propaganda, because in our Citizenship Act, CAA allows for fast tracking of citizenship, but no authority is available to anybody to take away anybody's citizenship. Like, you know, India, once you and me are citizens of this country, no political establishment can take away our citizenship. I can relinquish it, I can discard it, but nobody can take away. So these misconceptions about NRC and also about CAA, we have done enough homework to explain to our friends in Bangladesh. We have very good relations with the Bangladesh government, especially the Awami League government led by Madam Sheikh Hasina. She's a very strong leader, very strong Democrat, very committed leader. That's the reason why she has been winning election after election. Third time she became the Prime Minister. And India enjoys a very strong bilateral relationship with that country. Both under Manmohan Singh's government and Modi ji's government, we have been able to explain our position well to our neighbors.
Ramadhav ji, we started our conversation with a chat about the outreach that you did as spokesperson for the RSS and also in terms of your writings, etc., with the outside world, not preaching to the converted, etc., etc., where you did talk about the importance of dialogue and reaching out to people who were otherwise not convinced or didn't have much information about logical. We have, you have written about democracy, and I have marked that page in my copy of your book. And you said that earlier, democracy just meant the rule of the people. What we practice is the rule of the majority, but we have to guard against the tendencies of illiberalism in our democracy. For that, we need leaders who have absolute faith in the three cardinal principles that guided the French Revolution: liberty, equality, and fraternity. Liberal constitutionalism is what you are advocating. And that, of course, has a huge emphasis again on dialogue. We have a whole host of farmers and, groups who are agitating at the Delhi border, various points at the moment. Of course, government is engaged in dialogue with them. But do you think that before things could have reached at this stage, something could have been done even while pushing through these reform, you know, agri-reform bills, because of which your own ally walked out of the alliance, that stakeholders could have been taken on board. And maybe dialogue would have lengthened the process of getting there. But once things had been agreed on, we would have had a more smooth sailing in terms of this reform journey.
See, the forum for dialogue in a democratic setup is the parliament. I mean, at the political level, at the people's level, if you want to have any dialogue, it is the government, the parliament, which is the forum for that dialogue. The bills were placed before the parliament. You are right. One of our partners, one of our alliance partners has left us, articulating its opposition to this particular reform. But you must also remember that many who are not our alliance partners came forward to support it also. So there was discussion. That's the reason why parties in the South, including my home state like Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, from there parties came forward to support it and all that. Today, very interestingly, the organization which is leading the farmers' protests, the Bharatiya Kisan Union, it is the same organization which had in 2019, just before the elections, reached out to us, reached out to BJP with a Freedom of Farmers Manifesto, Farmers Freedom Manifesto. And they asked us to incorporate many of their demands in our manifesto. What all they mentioned in that manifesto, the Bharatiya Kisan Union's manifesto, it is available on the web, on the internet. Anybody can see it. What Prime Minister Modi did through these three reform acts was precisely to fulfill that agenda that Bharatiya Kisan Union demanded us to do before the election just 1 year ago. When we do that, today, they again mobilize people, some mislead some people, some farmers, and bring them under the streets and now say, no, you now remove all the, recall all the three acts. We don't want those acts. No, it is utter duplicity. You wanted it. And at that time, Congress Party, Mr. Rahul Gandhi, had supported the demands of Bharatiya Kisan Union. When today we are implementing those demands, both Congress Party and Kisan Union, both are fighting against us. It is sheer political opportunism and duplicity. Even then, government is ready to talk to the farmers. Government is ready to talk to political parties. Prime Minister held all-party meeting recently. We are ready to talk to you. You wanted this reform.
That's not the farm bills.
No, I'm saying we are ready to talk to all political parties, all agitating groups. We are doing that. We can engage with them. It has to be resolved. If there are any issues, they have to be resolved through dialogue. We firmly believe in that. That is the way forward in democracy, parliament, and of course, forums outside the parliament. We are ready to discuss.
Okay, Ram Madhavji, now I think it's time that we took some questions. We've had almost 40 minutes of conversation on various issues and the things that you have covered in your book. I just tried to pick out, little subjects, small little enclaves, and try to talk around it. And now I would like to kind of share some of the questions which haven't actually, we were supposed to get them on the scroll, but we haven't got, now... let's see. I think we are getting some questions here. Okay, somebody's saying, welcome to the session. I think we can both thank him on our behalf. Can we have some of the questions, please?
There should not be many questions because I have been very clear in my answers.
Yeah, but we just have a welcome.
You see, about since the last question was about the farmers' bills, the APMCs, agriculture produce.
Okay, you're getting one question here. I'm not sure who has sent it. The question is, what is your one-liner for nationality?
One-liner is, nationality is an emotion, a sentiment, a commitment. Farmers' protests questions reform the promotes efficiency of agriculture, not well-being of agriculture.
I think we're getting something on. It's not a question; it's a statement on.
Let me talk about farmers' protest. Let me take up this issue of farmers' protest a little bit more.
Please share your thoughts on farmer protest questions, reforms that promote efficiency of agriculture, not the well-being of agriculturists. It makes a distinction between the activity of agriculture and the life agriculturists.
Let me take it up. I don't know how do you completely separate agriculture from agriculturists. I don't know. I mean, what was meant by that? I don't know. But let me address that issue, that concern. You see, what the farm acts now, they have become acts now. What they do is three things. One, they give freedom to farmer to sell his produce either to the mandis. Mandis will very much be there. The middlemen who deal through mandis will be there. They can continue to sell to the mandis, or if they are willing to sell it to somebody outside, they can go and sell it outside. That's number one. Number two, they can fix the price as per their wish. Earlier, Essential Commodities Act used to regulate the pricing of our products. Together with that used to come this whole MSP, minimum support price. MSP has distorted India's agricultural patterns, crop patterns, very badly. You know, today I have nothing against farmers who are cultivating rice in Punjab, but Punjab large parts of Punjab have water issues, and paddy is a water guzzler. But today Punjab, every farmer goes for basmati cultivation, water guzzling cultivation, because there is an MSP there, there's a guarantee. So there is a distortion in this. So now farmer is independent. Whether he wants a particular product to be sold at this price or that price, he is free. Government is not restricting. Third, farmer can go and enter into direct contract with private agribusinesses. If an agribusiness says, I will give you money, please produce moongfali, he can do that. Let the farmer get the aid from agribusiness companies. Earlier, that freedom was not there. Now, this is in the interest of the farmer. It is not that farmers are going to be, defeated, but agriculture is going to succeed. It's not like that. When agriculture succeeds, agriculture's efficiency improves, farmer will be better off. That is the whole effort. And this APMC, which we all talk about as a big panacea. You know how it came into existence. During the British rule, they wanted cotton from Central Indian farmers for their cotton mills in London. They introduced the system of mandis. They said cotton farmers in Central India must sell their cotton produce only to the British run mandis. Mandis would procure it at the rate they fixed, and then export it to their cotton mills in, Manchester and elsewhere. Right. An exploited system of the British. And the Bharatiya Kisan Union, when they asked us for reform, they mentioned it. This British time law should go. And today, when we removed that British time law, they are saying, no, bring back that British time law. So it is, it is in the farmers that we should understand.
We'll take question number three now. And after that, we'll only take, I think, one more question. Question, we're running out of time. Is nationalism the only criteria of governance?
Nationalism is not the criteria, any political criteria. Nationalism is an emotion, a sentiment, a feeling that you have for the country, your people, your neighbor, and your not so neighborly person who is far off from you. That is nationalism. Feeling for the country, sentiment for the country. What government is bothered about is citizenship. Whether you are a citizen of this country or not. So we should not mix up these two things.
Okay. Any other questions? I think that's it. We are done with the questions as well, and well within time. This was certainly an interesting conversation, as was presaged right at the beginning. We are getting a request for you, a request to you from the central government. For the central government, through you, the government must engage with the protesters, listen to what they say. The future of crucial agriculture reforms depend on it. There's somebody called Ashutosh Kumar Thakur who has sent this request. Ramadhaji, you could possibly send this request to the central government. They might listen to you more than they do to the others. And
certainly, I assure Thakurji. I assure Thakurji that yes, government is already engaged in talking to the leaders of the protesters. But I must tell you, in fact, today in Hindustan Times, I wrote about it. I said we should talk to those who are protesting, but also talk to the farmers across the country, both in Orissa, in Bengal, in Andhra Pradesh, in Telangana, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, across the country. We should talk to the farmers, explain to them the benefits of the new reforms and seek their opinion also. Just because a section is protesting, government need not think that that is the voice of the entire country, farmers of the entire country. We need to engage with the entire country. We should find out if the country feels like on MSP, if there is a concern that there should be MSP regime continued, I believe that it's a genuine concern. It can be probably addressed by the government. So like that, yes, I totally agree that we should engage and government is engaging.
Well, that was a very interesting conversation, as I said earlier, and we're finishing up well within time. I would also like to thank the Kalinga Literary Festival on my own behalf for asking me to do this. I was, I must say, extremely reluctant because I'm not very good at digital stuff, but this was an interesting conversation. I was glad to be part of it, and very interesting answers from Ramadhavji, and as always, and I would, of course, like to speak to you some more on Kashmir, but we can do that probably offline. Another reminder to everybody, this book, Because India Comes First, is now out and it's also available on Amazon. Thank you very much, Ram Madhavji, for this conversation.
Thank you, Nishla. It was a wonderful conversation. I enjoyed it. Thank you. And thank you, Kalinga Lit Fest.